So these days it's difficult to address political meetings because there's so much at stake, and it's very difficult to put to analyze the situation. So I stand with what I stand unconditionally is in terms of opposing implementation of imposing sedition on Sharjeel Imam, and I demand his immediate release to that extent. But as Ladeeda said, yours is an unconditional support, mine is a conditional support to Sharjeel Imam. And I have few questions, and these questions come from my engagement, public engagement, and in terms of certain doubts. As Shaheen, I think, made a right point that Shaheen Bagh stands for a universal kind of a citizenship, not citizenship only for the Muslim or Muslim women, for everyone else. I think this is the ideal even Constitution of India witnessed and had enshrined. But it's a much more complex process than what we generally visualize it to be. Especially in a country like India, which is layered, textured and complex, with caste and religion both being mired in a caste system, which is a ladder-like structure. Therefore, each of the issues that we discuss, whether asserting of our Muslim identity, whether we assert our Dalit identity, or when we assert our OBC backward identity, it is not a single datum, it is not unified, it is not homogeneous. So to me, the question would be to frame in terms of Sharjeel's assertion of Muslim identity. Does it stand for reassertion in public sphere of public space, or does it stand for assertion of justice? And I think these are two distinctly different questions, and one cannot collapse one and collate one with the other. Standing for question of justice would be standing for citizenship, and when we talk of citizenship or when we talk of the question of justice, then to me it is a double-entered process. It is not a linear process where it is sufficient for me to assert merely as a Muslim against a Brahminical Hindu fascist state. That's one dimension of it. And that's just one dimension of the situation. The other dimension that I would also bring into question is the one who's asserting his identity, the one who's asserting this kind of a righteous politics against an authoritarian regime that we're witnessing today, are they also prepared to be self-critical of their own religion and their religious practices? If a Dalit Bahujan is raising, there is no single, and this is what we've witnessed in the last 10 years, last 5-6 years of the BJP experiment, that we believe that Dalit and Bahujan is a single datum, we believe that they had a certain secular direction, but you could see that how systematically in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, they were subdivided, and the hegemonic power game internal to these communities was exploited by Hindutva, and a large chunk of support was swept away to the Hindutva brigade. This question, I think, becomes extremely important in today's context. And that's where I feel I'm not as assured as Ladeeda and Shaheel about Sharjeel's politics. That does this assertion of Muslim identity also involve space for internal self-critic? Does assertion of Kashmiri identity also involve a critique of the Sunni Muslims' discrimination against Muslims in Rajouri and Pooch, against Sunni Muslims of the Valley and their discrimination of Muslims in Ladakh, against the discrimination of Gujars, against the discrimination along gendered lines? Today, Hindutva is building a question of majoritarianism, to my mind, while it is top-down, but its roots lay in this bottom-up mechanism. Today, democracy is faltering, and perhaps it feels like it's in its last breath, precisely because Hindutva has managed to convince the majority, not just the Hindu majority, I think majority across castes, religion and castes, that just standing for justice would mean losing a bit of our own privileges. And standing for injustice, the way muscular majoritarianism is being built by Hindutva forces, makes us assured of our own privileges. Therefore, this intolerance, this business of intolerance, this business of muscular nationalism, this business of muscular majoritarianism, each one of is part of that game. And especially in a context where it is so, power relations are so skewed between a tiny dominant caste Hindu minority in one sense and swaths of majority. So the power flows is uneven and unequal. It's extremely unequal between two ends, polar opposites or two polar ends. But it's also uneven within each of these communities. Therefore, Hindu right-wing, Hindu politics are able to address both these dimensions of iniquitous distribution of power and unevenness within the subaltern communities. Secularism, citizenship, democracy and constitutionalism today cannot mean what they meant in the past. Simply standing for an anti-right-wing Hindutva for me is not justice. It's merely assertion of your identity. Justice will come when you add, along with assertion of your identity, discriminatory practices that exist across castes and religions. What about religious discrimination within minority religious communities? Who is going to raise this question? What about the question of caste within minorities? What about masculinity within OBC castes? Who is going to raise these questions? Hindutva is the only politics that understands this and is able to make a very insidious kind of a link with majoritarianism. Unfortunately, secular, associational, progressive left politics in this country have fundamentally disallowed us from raising these questions. As long as we do not raise these questions and keep a black and white kind of politics between one side universal citizenship, other side totalitarianism, one side is all about identity and other side is all about hegemony. My own understanding is that Hindutva is going to only further get entrenched in this country. We'll have to smudge this binary. Raising of identity should also be about justice. And that justice, I think, is a fairly complex business in Indian context, and I think we have missed fair amount of historical opportunities. What we are witnessing today is the backlog of a failed developmental state, failed opportunities, and therefore I argue that there are three dominant poles that have emerged in Indian political narrative. One is the left liberal constitutional kind of narrative, which is still sticking on to a universal discourse, but which has very little purchase and which has very little social base that is left for this kind of a discourse. Second, you have the Dalit, Bahujan, Muslim kind of an identity discourse that is emerging, which is refusing to make a distinction between left and right. And third, you have the Hindutva variant, which essentially represents a cultural subaltern of India. And this is the tragedy of Indian democracy, that the cultural subaltern today is being represented a far right politics, which is essentially represents a cultural subaltern, but in essence is regressive and wants to reimpose the old kind of social hierarchy. And there's a long history why this cultural subaltern of various kinds have gone with Hindutva politics. This whole business of anti-elitism that right very successfully combines with communalism. So there is a class, caste dimension that is combined with communal question. So it is not merely an anti-Muslim regime. This regime, I think, is a much more complex, as I think Shaheen was intending, that Muslim is just a red herring. Anti-Muslim politics allows them space for experimenting lot many other things which they are recalibrating. Therefore, every politics, whether it is Muslim, whether it is Dalit Bahujan, whether it is left secular, has to take this entire totality into account. Unfortunately, in the politics, in Indian politics, social groups have got ghettoized. Every group feels that it is the primary victim. You ask a tribal, they will say, we are the primary victim. You ask a Muslim, he says, I am the victim of this country. You ask Dalits, they said, we have faced untouchability which Muslims don't. If you want to recombine political subjectivity, I think we'll have to raise and frame political questions keeping this context in mind. That if you have these three, the reason why Hindutva is growing is that each of our politics is building a circular logic. We are getting caught in that limited circular logic, and beyond that, we do not have alternatives to offer. So therefore, for me, Sharjeel's political position is still an open-ended. While I appreciate, while I see the context in which he's raising the question of Muslimhood, that he has a right to have his dignity as a Muslim, I think I'm fully with that. But to say that that assertion itself is a secular and a progressive and an assertion for justice, I will have my serious doubts. Because for that, as I said, it has to combine a lot more questions. We'll have to take a lot more. And as Foucault would say, that fascism in us all, we all are carriers of power. We are all into this power game by choice or by default. Unless we do not question our own social location, unless Sharjeel is not ready to question his male positionality within his religion, I don't think there's a question of justice unproblematically involved in his politics. And what is that he will do to give up that privilege, to internally democratize? I think the real question and the real resistance to Hindutva lies in this internal question. That as long as we are able to fight, as long as we are willing to raise this question of secularism against Hindutva, my own understanding is that Hindutva is more than happy to offer you that space. Because they know that as long as the question of justice is not raised in a fundamental sense in this internal way, I think today's historical progression shows me that Hindutva and the majoritarian politics, whether it's Hindutva or some other kind of vulgar majoritarianism, is the only option. And it's a global trend, and it has complex linkages with neoliberal economy and political economy. I'm not going to all of that. Is the only option, because intolerance has become the only way to register your presence in the social system today. And Modi's personality is precisely a kind of an embodiment, depiction of representation of that. That intolerance and aggression is the only way that you can sort of map and engrave yourself on the political cartography of Indian nationhood. Therefore, to have an alternative discourse, we'll have to rethink our political subjectivity through internal discourse. That internally each group, and where would that social energy, where would that social vision of justice come? It's something, a question that I'm not really very clear, especially in a context where the power relations are so skewed. Because the moment you raise this question, it itself becomes so politically loaded that you cannot equate. At a normative moral plane, this question can have an equivalence, but on a concrete political social plane, this becomes a loaded question, because power groups and power is unfairly loaded against certain social groups. Therefore, how are we going to even find an entry point to raise such a question? And unless we don't raise this and frame questions of secularism, justice and constitutionalism and citizenship through this, my own hunch would be that Hindutva and majoritarianism of the Hindutva kind will only find more space. And I thank you for this opportunity. Thank you.